Morning, everyone. We're glad that you're here and joining with us online today. We have one big announcement that we want to make. On May 24th, we will be opening back up for our building services, and we will have our 8:30 and our 10:30 worship service. Both services will be in the new building. That way we can spread out and obey the 6-foot rule that they want us to obey. But we look forward to that. We hope that you'll be able to join back up with us on the 24th if you feel as though you can do that. Also, today is Mother's Day. And usually Mother's Day is one of our biggest days here at the church. And we are sorry that you cannot be here today and that we can't honor you in a very special way. But we do have a video we want to share with you and to honor our mothers. I look forward to this day. For the first time in over 40 years, I'll be able to go and spend some time with my mom today. And I look forward to that. And I hope you look forward to spending some time honoring your mothers as well today. So sit back, enjoy this video that we want to use to honor our mothers.
Today is a unique day, and it's far bigger than we think, because there are many different kinds of mothers, and all are being honored today. For the mother who's chosen to stay at home while her children are little, may your patience be great and your influence even greater. For the single mom who never planned on doing this alone, may you be consistently strengthened by your Heavenly Father, and may you hear His voice singing over you. For the mother who strives to balance work outside the home with love inside the home, may you be given energy, validation, and hope as you make the leap from one world to another every day. For moms who had poor mothers themselves, but who now refuse to let that pattern repeat itself, may the godly legacy you've started be carried on for generations to come. For mothers with grown adult children, may today be filled with laughter and joy, and may you experience deep satisfaction and fulfillment. For women who have no biological children of their own, but who mother younger women as mentors, may you understand your role as a calling from God and as a transformation of their hearts. Today is a unique day. So for all the mothers we mentioned, and even those we didn't, be blessed, be honored, be filled with joy. You are making the world a better place because you're filling it with a love that only a mom can give.
Valentine's Day occurs every February 14th across the United States and in many other places around the world. Candy, flowers, and gifts are exchanged between loved ones, all in the name of St. Valentine. But who is this mysterious saint, and where did all these traditions come from? The Catholic Church recognizes at least three different saints named Valentine or Valentinus, all of whom were martyred. One legend said that Valentine was a priest who served in the 3rd century during Rome. When Emperor Claudius II decided that single men made better soldiers than men with wives and families, he outlawed marriage for young men. Valentine, realizing the injustice of this, continued to marry young people who were secretly in love. When Valentine's actions were discovered, Claudius ordered that he be put to death. While in prison, Valentine was visited by many people who encouraged him with notes and flowers. One of the frequent visitors was the daughter of a prison guard, who he developed a strong friendship with. On the day Valentine was scheduled to be beaten and beheaded, February 14th, AD 270, he left his friend a note signed, "Love from your Valentine." A pope 2 centuries later set aside February 14th to honor St. Valentine. Gradually, that date became the time each year for exchanging love messages like simple gifts and flowers. This story cannot be proven with certainty, but the fact is, we don't need a speculative legend to inspire us with an account of sacrificial love. This is the purpose of us partaking the Lord's Supper each week. The Lord's Supper calls us to remember the ultimate act of sacrificial love. What is the Bible's definition of love? I'll read from 1 John chapter 4 to answer this question. Verse 8 says, "Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love." Here we see that love is one of the best words to describe God's character because of the fact that God is love. The next two verses say this. "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." These two verses clearly show how God expresses his love for us. He expresses love by choosing his one and only Son to live a perfect life in order to free us from the chains of sin through his horrible death on the cross. This is a perfect example of sacrificial love. Jesus considered our needs more important than himself, and willingly suffered all the price of sin so that we wouldn't have to. Jesus knew how bad humanity needed a Savior, and out of his selfless love, he took on the task of becoming that Savior for us. That's the ultimate Valentine story, a story that inspires us to love selflessly, praise fervently, and remain faithful to Christ until our death. That's a story worth remembering, and that's a Savior worth following, no matter what earthly consequences we might face. Jesus defeated death, and if we remain faithful to him, we will defeat death one day too, and will dwell in heaven with him for all of eternity. Take the time this morning to remember and dwell on the greatest act of sacrificial love this world has ever seen. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you so much for just another day of beautiful life, Lord, that we can live to praise you and to study your word and just remember back to when you sent your son to die on the cross for our sins. God, we thank you so much for that act of love that was made by your son. I thank you for the example it sets for us on how to love sacrificially and selflessly, Lord. Thank you for all you've given us. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
So with Mother's Day coming up, we just wanted to talk a little bit about how God gives you a child to defend and protect through their lives. And even though us mothers are human, we tend to make mistakes. And we just think, Annie and I were talking about on the way over how amazing it is to have a defender in heaven who will never make those mistakes. He will constantly defend us and be there for us through all of our strives. So this song is kind of about that mother's love and how she will defend her child, but also about how God will be there forever.
My greatest defense, it leads me from gonna stay still.
Good morning. We are looking forward today to the looking at God's Word in the book of Luke, the 14th chapter. And so if you want to turn over there and hold that until it's time for me to begin reading the scripture, that would be great. I want to start a series of messages today over the next few weeks. We'll be looking at the topic of guess who's coming to dinner. And we're going to be looking at some of the dinner invitations that Jesus accepted and some of the opportunities that he had to teach God's will to those who invited him to dinner. When we send out a formal invitation, though, we need to be careful how we word that invitation. Such was the case of one mother who was looking for a suitor for her daughter. She had met this military officer and was very intrigued by him. She and her husband were wanting to get the daughter out of the house, get her married off so that they could enjoy their retirement years, but she seemed to be loving living at home. And so she thought about throwing a formal dinner party and inviting this officer in hopes that she and this young man would hit it off and would one day marry and they would be rid of her. So the formal invitation read as follows. Mr. and Mrs. Dabney request the pleasure of Captain Black's company at dinner on the 16th of September at 6 p.m. sharp. She was somewhat dismayed when she got this reply from Officer Dabney. With the exception of four men on leave and two sick soldiers, Captain Black's company, with much pleasure, will enjoy your dinner on September 16th at 6 p.m. sharp. Oops, she made a mistake when she sent out that wording, didn't she? You know, the cornerstone of any ideal dinner is the guest. In Jesus' day, that was the most intriguing thing. If Jesus was invited to a dinner, all the movers and shakers of society wanted to be there. They wanted to be in his presence. They wanted to hear what he had to say. They wanted to see what he was going to do. If Jesus was going to be there, they wanted to be invited. Back in 1967, there was a movie that came out by the title, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner? It starred Spencer Tracy, Katharine Hepburn, and Sidney Poitier. And the film was one of the few films that was controversial in that time because it depicted an interracial marriage in a positive light. In fact, up until that time, there were still 17 states, mostly in the South, that had laws that forbid interracial marriage. And so it was a controversial movie at the time that it debuted. And needless to say, when Jesus was invited to dinner, the movers and the shakers of his day were looking for an opportunity to say, guess who's coming to dinner? And what they did not understand was that when Jesus was invited to dinner, and when he showed up, there was going to be some controversy. Can you even begin to imagine what it would be like to sit down and dine with Jesus over dinner? You know, have you ever had one of those uncomfortable meals in your life? I know I've had a few over the years. I remember as a young youth ministry, and my first ministry as a weekend ministry, I was invited to dinner at an elder's house on a Sunday afternoon. The Matthews had two young boys, Mark and Ross, who were in my junior church at the time. His youngest son, Ross, came out of his bedroom fully dressed in an Indian outfit, including a headdress. He had around his waist a belt with a sheath and a rubber knife, and he pulled the rubber knife out and he showed it to me. And I said, you know what that rubber knife's used for, don't you? And he said, no. And I said, well, when you get your meal, you take your knife out and you cut your meal with the rubber knife. Now, I didn't think any more about it, but sure enough, after the table had been set and Dale had offered prayer, little Ross took out his rubber knife and he began to carve up his meal. His dad yelled at him and asked him, Ross, what in the world are you doing? What are you thinking? Without any hesitation, this five-year-old had the wherewithal to throw his youth minister under the bus. He said, Mr. Tim told me to do it. I sat there with a red face and sort of like an Indian face itself, and I was embarrassed, and I took my chastisement from this elder who really raked me over the coals. Not only was it an uncomfortable dinner, but it was a very uncomfortable afternoon as well. You know what I'm talking about. You sort of feel out of place, in over your head, out of your leg. That's how I felt that day. I wonder if Jesus felt a little bit like this at this dinner that he was invited to. He was a guest. And except for only a couple other comments that we see in this whole story, Jesus is the one who does all the talking. Look at me at verse 1 in Luke chapter 14. On one Sabbath day, Jesus went to eat dinner in the home of the leader of the Pharisees, and the people were watching him closely. Here he was, a prominent Pharisee, perhaps a member of the Sanhedrin, and they invited guests to their home, including Jesus, and they were watching him closely. You talk about an uncomfortable dinner. In this short series of messages, guess who's coming to dinner? We're looking at the lessons that Jesus taught and the lessons we are meant to learn as Jesus eats with different people. I think there are three lessons here that we need to learn. There's three lessons here that we don't want to miss. Number one is this: it's never the wrong time to do the right thing. It's never the wrong time to do the right thing. Look at verses 2-6. There was a man there whose arms and legs were swollen. Jesus asked the Pharisees and the experts in religious law, "Is it permitted in the law to heal people on the Sabbath day or not?" When they refused to answer, Jesus touched the sick man and healed him and sent him away. And then he turned to them and said, "Which of you doesn't work on the Sabbath? If your son or your cow falls into a pit, don't you rush to get him out?" Again, they could not answer. That's sort of kind of strange to me here, to find a sick person at such a prestigious dinner. The context of the passage has this sick man at the home of this prominent Pharisee, and there's probably two reasons for this. One, it was a setup. You know, they were always trying to trick Jesus, always trying to trap him. Maybe this man was invited to this dinner to see what Jesus would do on a Sabbath day. That's probably the case. But the second possibility is this man was a needy person, and needy people were permitted to be there in order to take home the scraps or the leftovers from the meal. So at a dinner such as this, the poor and the needy were allowed to be close in order for them to take what was left over. And maybe this is why he was here. This poor man has possibly one of the worst things that a person could ever have, and that is congestive heart failure. The King James Version calls it dropsy. His body was retaining great amounts of fluid. He would have been in a great deal of pain, and he would have had difficulty breathing because it would be constricting around his lungs and his heart. My grandmother died of congestive heart failure, and the last month of her life was very painful for her and very untelling for her. In fact, she was filled with so much fluid that in one day, through the medicine that they gave her, they took off 18 pounds of fluid. So here he is right in front of Jesus. He's in pain. He's suffering. You know, the easiest thing in the world to do for any of us would be to just let him go, to do nothing. To see someone in suffering as this man was and simply do nothing. To drive right on by, to ignore the situation, to not get involved. While that may be the easiest thing to do, it's not the right thing to do. See, it's never a wrong time to do the right thing. And that's what Jesus takes into consideration here. Even though it's on the Sabbath, even though it's forbidden for them to do any work on the Sabbath, Jesus knew that this man was suffering and he wanted to do something about it. He was not going to pass by and do nothing. Knowing what was going on in the mind of the Pharisee in whose house he was about to dine, Jesus asked him and his guests that important question: is it permitted for someone to heal people on the Sabbath according to the law? Is it permitted or not? And they refused to answer Jesus. Then Jesus did what he always does. He healed the man and he sent him on his way. He made his life better. He removed the man's suffering and pain. He sent him away well. You know, today, if you come to Jesus as Savior, you too could go home spiritually well. You know, the heartaches and the pains of life, while they may not disappear, become far easier when we know that Jesus is carrying that burden for us. What kind of lesson is Jesus teaching here? What does he want them to understand? What did he want the Pharisee and the experts in the law to see? He wanted them to see that it's never the wrong time to do the right thing. In verses 5 and 6, he's basically saying, you guys get real. Get real with me for a moment. You know, you're going to criticize me and you're going to have false accusations against me because I heal on the Sabbath, but you would do the same thing. Let's say your son falls into a pit or your cow falls in the pit. Aren't you going to go out and rescue them at that moment in time? Aren't you going to do that right then and there? Are you going to wait till the next day? No. You're going to go out and rescue your son. You're going to go out and rescue your cow. And they knew that Jesus was telling the truth, but they had nothing to say. They were being seen, but not heard. Why didn't Jesus wait till the next day? Because he wanted to show them that it's never the wrong time to do the right thing. There's no time frame when it comes to kindness and compassion. The man was suffering. Jesus could do something about it right then and there, and he did. You know, as we dine with Jesus, he's reminding us to be that kind of person who's going to show kindness and compassion whenever the opportunity arises. And we shouldn't put it off. We shouldn't ignore it. We need to quit making excuses and do the right thing. That's why I like Ephesians 4:32. Instead of be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Jesus has forgiven you. Galatians 6:10, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. Here at the dinner table, there's a second lesson that we need to learn. That is, there's never a right time to have the wrong attitude. Never a right time to have the wrong attitude. Look at verses 7 through 11. When Jesus noticed that all who had come to the dinner were trying to sit in the seats of honor near the head of the table, he gave them this advice. When you're invited to a wedding feast, don't sit in the seat of honor. What if someone who is more distinguished than you has also been invited? The host will come to you and say, give that person your seat. Then you'll be embarrassed and you will have to take whatever seat is left at the foot of the table. Instead, take the lowest place at the foot of the table. Then when your host sees you, he will come to you and say, friend, we have a better place for you. Then you will be honored in front of all the other guests. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. John Maxwell wrote, there are two kinds of pride, both good and bad. Good pride represents our dignity and self-respect. Bad pride is the deadly sin of superiority that reeks of conceit and arrogance. The kind of pride that Jesus is talking about here is the second kind of pride, the one that is a deadly sin of superiority that reeks of conceit and arrogance. The Pharisee and his friends reeked of this kind of pride, and this is what Jesus saw as the dinner began. The guests were picking their seats of honor. Why? Because they thought they deserved them. They thought they were the movers and the shakers, and everyone else had to bow down to them. Their attitude of superiority demanded that they seek these seats for themselves. Billy Graham once said, the smallest package I ever saw was a man wrapped up wholly in himself. Ezra Benson wrote, essentially, pride is a my will rather than thy will approach to life. So these men were all about their will, getting their way, when they should have been about the Father's will. You know, Jesus was all about the Father's will. Jesus said, I came to do the will of my Father who is in heaven. And so he's sharing this lesson here. When we are prideful people, we're going to be humble. It's going to happen. Honor is granted to the person, but it cannot be grasped by the person. You know, Jesus saw a great deal of pride being displayed at this dinner by the guests who felt they were important enough to demand the best seats. There is no easy cure for pride, but to overcome it. It has to start with an awareness and a determination to allow it to die in our lives. Paul wrote in Romans 12:3, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. God wants us to humble ourselves. But if we are blind to our pride, if we're arrogant about our worth, then he will directly or indirectly fulfill verse 11 in our lives. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Friends, pride is an attitude God cannot use. Pride is a spiritual killer. But we can choose to humble ourselves by confessing, forsaking our sin, especially the sin of pride, and be born again of God. There's one final lesson here that I think we need to learn, and that is there is plenty of room at the table for everyone. Jesus sort of shifts gears here in these last few verses. He makes a comparison here between this meal and the great banquet that God is throwing for others. Let me share with you a few thoughts from this portion of Jesus' teaching. Alan Walker shares these thoughts. He says, the invitation is for all. Look at verse 16. Jesus replied with this story. A man prepared a great feast, and he sent out many invitations. Now, we need to understand something here. When it says he sent out many invitations, we are included in the many. We probably would not have been prestigious enough to be invited to this Pharisee's home, but when it comes to the invitation of Jesus, all are invited. We may have been one of the poor sitting on the outside waiting for some scraps, waiting for some leftovers. But Jesus assures us that God invites each and every one of us. We're all invited. There's room at his banquet table for everyone. No matter who we are, no matter what walk of life we come from, there's room at God's banquet table. A second lesson here is that many will reject that invitation. Look at verses 18 through 20. But they all began making excuses. One said, I have just bought a field, must inspect it, please excuse me. Another said, I have just bought 5 pair of oxen, and I want to try them out, please excuse me. And another said, I just got married, so I can't come. You know, there's all kinds of excuses. Some are humorous. You know, Outreach Magazine, a Christian magazine, asked ministers to offer some of the most bizarre excuses they've ever heard people offer for not being a part of the church. Let me share a few of the most absurd ones. One lady said, we are out of peanut butter. Now, of course, you can't come to church unless you have your fix on peanut butter. Another guy said, both of my girlfriends attend that church. Now, I think this guy has some other issues besides his excuse. One guy said the worship leader pulls up his pants too often. It's distracting. Well, maybe we should just let his pants fall off and see how distracting that would be. One woman said, my kids take nap during that time. To that, I would say, bring them anyway. They can nap with a few others. But here's my favorite. My wife cooked bacon for breakfast, and our entire family smells like bacon. I guess their shower must have been broken, but hey, come on anyway. Who doesn't like the smell of bacon? Now, I could go on with all these absurd excuses, but I think that's enough for now. Not all excuses are humorous. Some are sad. Such was the case here, the excuses that were offered for not accepting the invitation. One guy said, I bought some land, and I have to go check it out. I have to examine a field that I purchased sight unseen. Man, I would love to see that guy coming if I had a field that was worth nothing for sale. Possessions. I just bought 5 set of oxen. I have to try them out. Now, which one of you guys in this church buy a new truck sight unseen without trying it out? We wouldn't do that, would we? The other guy offered relationships as an issue. He said, I just got married. Well, here, let me tell you something. All property will be destroyed one day with fire. All oxen will die one day, and all relationships will end. But the banquet in heaven is going to last for all eternity. If you've been offering some excuses for not accepting the invitation of Jesus to become the Lord of your life, if you have, then stop it. Forget the excuse making and come and give your life to Christ. Another one here, a lesson we learn, is to invite as many as you can to the banquet of God. Look at verses 21 through 23. The servant returned and told his master what they had said. The master was furious and said, go out quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town and invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. And after the servant had done this, he reported, there's still room for more. So his master said, go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. Twice, the command is given, go. Verse 21, go quickly. Verse 23, go out. Look at the urgency here in the story of Jesus. This is more than a Big Mac and a side of fries. This is more than a Friday night dinner out with your wife at Longhorns. We're talking about eternity here. Jesus is saying heaven is at stake, and we must be involved in the invitation process. See, Jesus' goal here, plainly stated in verse 23, so that the house will be full. God's house. You know, the final lesson here is found in verse 24. Those who reject the invitation are left out altogether. For none of those I first invited will get even the smallest taste of my banquet. Did you get that? They won't have even the smallest taste of the Lord's banquet. It's pretty easy to figure out what Jesus is talking about here. Jesus saying the invitation is extended, but if you decline, you're not going to have any part in heaven. And we learn quickly, don't miss it. Excuses don't mean a thing. If you turn down the offer, you're going to miss out entirely on the great feast that God has prepared for you. Let me ask you this morning, do you know Jesus? Do you have faith in him? Do you trust him enough for your salvation? Have you been buried with him in baptism for the forgiveness of your sins? Have you received that gift of the promised Holy Spirit in your life? Is he the Lord of all that you do? There's still time right now for you to come and accept the invitation of Jesus Christ. I don't know what they had for dinner the night Jesus was the guest of honor, but when they left, they had more than a stomach full. Their spirits were filled as well. Jesus may have been the popular guest at the banquet, but he touched on some very subjects that were uncomfortable for his host and for his friends to hear. They were topics that wouldn't make Jesus popular in their eyes. And even those lessons today are for us. They're still relevant. Kindness and compassion. There's never a wrong time to do the right thing. Pride versus humility. There's never a right time to have the wrong attitude. Excuses in eternity. God's inviting each and every one of us. The question is, will we dine at the table of the Lord? Will we accept that invitation? As we have dined with Jesus and his guests, we've learned some valuable lessons that Jesus felt important enough to share with us in his word. The question is, what will you do with them? Let's pray. Father, today we look at this story in the life of Christ and realize that there are so many people who reject your invitation, but yet you still want them to come. You still want them to be a part of the great banquet feast in heaven. And we look forward, Lord, to that day as a Christian to know that we will be with you for all eternity, but we know there are others here who need to be invited. May we be the ones who show kindness and compassion. May we be the ones who set aside pride and humble ourselves before you, knowing that you will lift us up. May we be the ones who offer the invitation. May we be the church that welcomes the lost sinner. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.